Awesome. Hey everyone, so today Shankar will be talking about one of the major contributions he did to the navigation stack, which is environment change detection. We were facing issues about, you go to a factory, you run the navigation stack on a map which already exists, and then we realized that the localization is failing because a lot of things inside the map has changed. So we tasked Shankar to figure out when the map has changed and to tell the person or the operator that, hey, the map has changed. Either we are in a different room or the environment has changed a lot. So you better map the environment again. Otherwise, the performance will deteriorate. So this was one of the main projects that Shankar did, apart from a lot of other projects during his internship. Shankar, back to you now.
Yeah. Thank you, Guru. Hey, everyone. Good evening. So, environment change detection, this was, as Puru had just said before, this was the major project that I contributed when I was interning, when I'm interning at Moi 2. This was the first project that was, most of the other works that I had worked on was like features to the navigation stack, but this was one of the things that I had completely worked on from scratch. So, and I learned a lot. I hope I can share some of that with you. So today, what we are going to just go through the why we need environment change detection, how we actually are doing it currently, and a few other technical details and the problems I faced and how we can take this, how it can be used forward. So quickly, what is environment change detection? So as Puru had mentioned, most of the robots, when we deploy them, we're going to have a map. And we just run the navigation stack in a pure localization mode. So if we need a good pose estimate from the localization node, the map has to be perfect. So the environment in that the robot is currently working in has to be in accordance, has to be similar to the map that we are using for localization. So that is what environment change detection, it basically refers to, we try to detect if the world the robot is working in has changed too much. So that's just the gist of it. So why do we need it? So typically, most of these autonomous mobile robots, when they're deployed, initially we map the environment they're going to be operating in. And when the map is ready, we deploy the robot in pure localization mode. However, there can be small minor adjustments to the environment on a daily basis. And when this gets accumulated over time, the environment can be very drastically changed with respect to the map that we have. For instance, there could be new furniture could have been included, furniture could have been removed, things could have been moved around. So the entire environment could look completely different with the map that we have. So, and we can visualize this by looking at the map that the robot is using, but for an end user, this might be very tedious to do. So having an environment change detection node, a specific node that can detect this automatically, this was necessary. And when the change detection node says that, okay, the environment has changed too much, you have to remap, then the user can remap the environment. So that was the major, that's the reason why we need environment change. So how it works. So when Puru gave me this task and Arihant was my helped me throughout this. So when I discussed with Arihant, how are we going to approach this? So initially, what we thought was Movito's navigation stack has three different methods for localization. So one is using SLAM toolbox, one is using the particle filter localization, and another is cartographer. So what we thought was we could have different methods to detect that the localization is erroneous for each of these three different localization methods. So we were trying to identify techniques or metrics that were used in these individual algorithms that could help us to detect that the environment has changed. However, Arihant had already suggested that using a separate algorithm would be a very nice idea because it would be very, a separate algorithm that was more suitable for environment change detection would be able to detect these changes in a more precise manner. So after extensive literature survey, most papers were suggesting that scan matching as a method to supplement AIMS localization techniques like the particle filter localization that we were using. So what the reason why scan matching was used as a supplement is because in a very dynamic environment, when things have been moving around, particle filter localization might fail. And in that case, we can use scan matching to update the pose so that the particle filter localization does not break. We try to use this algorithm, we try to use this technique as a assessment of whether the environment has changed too much. So this using a separate algorithm for change detection also benefits us in another way. We don't have to figure out ways to do it for three different localization. We just have a separate node, it has a separate algorithm that does it perfectly. So we came up with scan matching. So what is scan matching? I'll just briefly go through that. So scan matching, if you have a scan or a map, or a scan and another scan, or a map and a map, scan matching techniques basically help us find the transformation that would align them. So this would help us. Scan matching is used in robotics to iteratively get the pose of the robot. But in this case, we are using scan matching in a different way. What we do is we match the map that we are having and the scan that the robot is currently publishing. We align them and we assess the quality of the match. And we based on the quality of the match, we state whether the environment has changed too much or not. So what we do is first we create a point cloud from the map. The map is in our navigation stack. The map mostly it's as an occupancy grid. We have to create a point cloud from it, and we also create a KD tree from the map's point cloud. I'll give more details as to why we need a KD tree. And then what we do is each time a scan is published, we convert that into a point cloud and we use ICP library to match these two point clouds. So the algorithm that does the scan matching, we went with ICP algorithm. There are a few other algorithms as well, but ICP was the one that was most extensively used and was readily available for us to make use of from existing libraries like PCL, Open3D, etc. So we tried ICP. So what ICP does is, given two point clouds P and Q, what ICP does is it associates each point in P and Q. It iterates through the points in P and it finds the nearest neighbor corresponding to that point in Q. So that point would be, so the point in P would be associated with a specific point in Q. Now this data association might not be perfect. As you can see in the first iteration, the last point in P is associated with this middle point in Q. However, so that data association might not be perfect in the beginning. So but the first step is data association. Second, we try to align the two point clouds. So we try to find transformations, rotations and translations that would align these two point clouds. Again, because of improper data associations, this alignment might not happen properly in the first attempt. So we try to iterate through this process again and again. We align it and then we again do data association. Repeatedly, we do this data association and alignment until the two point clouds converge and are aligned perfectly. Now, we don't use this algorithm is pure vanilla ICP, but we use a slightly modified version. We have three other termination criteria. We have a maximum number of iterations, and we also check if the previous transformation and the current estimated transformation is very small enough than a given set value. And if the sum of the Euclidean squared errors is smaller than a set defined threshold value. If any of these three cases are met, then we consider that the ICP algorithm has achieved proper registration of the two point clouds and we terminate them. So how do we assess, now that we have registered the 2-point codes, how do we assess that if the registration is good or not? So we do this by calculating what's called in, what we call inlays. So inlays are just basically points in the registered scan point cloud that exist in the map as well. For instance, in the map, if there's a particular object at say some location x comma y, if the scan point cloud also has a point in that same location, that's considered an end layer. So basically, that gives us an indication that okay, in this particular point, the map and the scan are matching. So things have not changed in that particular area. So what we do is we take the points from the registered scan cloud, the scan point cloud, and we search for it in the KD tree of the map. The reason why we go use a KD tree over here is basically because KD tree allows us to store multidimensional points, in this case 2D points in a tree, and the search complexity of this is highly optimized for neighborhood searches. That's the reason, it's basically for reducing the time complexity of the neighborhood search. That's the reason why we use a KD tree. So we take each point in the registered scan point cloud and we try to search for a corresponding point in the KD tree in a given radius. So that again is another parameter. So if an object has been nudged slightly to the left but is still within the radius that we define, then it's not considered too big of a change and it will be considered as an inlayer. So what we do is we calculate the number of inlayers. So basically, if the scan point cloud has around 720 points, we check how many of them have corresponding points in the KD tree. And that would give us an assessment of how good, how similar the environment is with the respect to this, with respect to the scan. And if this, if the inlayer percentage goes below a certain value, then we can state that the environment has changed too much and that remapping may be required. And some of the problems, one of the major problems that we faced for a really long time was the inlayer percentage would keep varying, and it would, we would not have a steady, we could not define a set threshold value. And the way we solved this issue was by, instead of matching every single scan that we get from the laser, from the LiDAR, instead of that, what we did was we introduced a rate at which we would match them. By introducing this, what happens is we were able to make the inlayer percentage more stable, and hence we could define a threshold value that if the, and when the inlayer percentage goes below it, then we can say that the environment has changed. So currently the matching rate, the frequency at which we match is at 0.5 hertz. And for some future work, so the ICP algorithm that is provided by PCL library also provides its own fitness score. This fitness score is basically some of the mean Euclidean, this is the sum of the Euclidean distance between the points in the Euclidean distance between the two scan clouds. So between the 2 point clouds. So this, the fitness score, if the registration is imperfect, this fitness score would be very high, because if in an improper registration, the point clouds are not going to be aligned perfectly. In that case, the points are going to have a long distance between them. We have, but this again, this ICP fitness score does is varies a lot, and we haven't been able to characterize it enough to make any proper use of it. But further study on it could probably lead, we could figure out a way to make use of it in some sense. And next, right now we are just giving a Boolean value to the user, whether or not the environment has changed too much. However, we can actually, using this, we can trigger autonomous remapping, or we can turn on SLAM so that the robot starts simultaneously localizing and mapping. And if you guys are interested in localization on mapping, Cyril Stackhouse's lectures were a great help to me. I was able to understand and visualize localization a lot. I was very new to localization, and Cyril Stackhouse's lectures were a great help. Apart from that, the reference repository for this particular, for this entire work was from SnapMap ICP. So this repository uses scan matching techniques to update the pose of AMCL or adaptive Monte Carlo localization. So this was a reference. That's it, guys. that's from me. If you guys have any doubts, does anyone have any questions or anything?
Hello.
Hi, Sabu.
Yeah, I'm probably getting this wrong, but if I understand correctly, the ICP algorithm, you said that when you give two sets of point cloud, it tries to match one with the other with some rotation transforms, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so but we generally don't want that, right? Like, let's say there is a map and for some reason the whole thing is rotated because some objects like moved around.
Okay, yes.
So don't we want that to be distinguished as a separate map?
Okay. The reason why we do this registration is because let me put it this way. So the map, when we convert the map into a point cloud, what we do first is when we get the scanned cloud, it's in the robot's frame of reference. First, we transform that to the map's frame of reference. So we do an initial transformation so that the scan point cloud and the map are perfectly aligned. It's perfectly rotated. So it's in the right frame of reference in the beginning.
Okay.
However, it could be slightly misaligned, and hence we do this registration so that we can align it perfectly, and then we count the NPOs.
Okay, got it. But it will be able to identify that if there is some huge rotation, right?
If the objects are moved around, from our test so far, it has been able to identify.
Okay. Got it.
Any other question, anyone? Awesome. This is quite a short presentation. I was expecting it to be like half an hour or something, but this was great, man. Thank you, Shankar.
Thank you so much. Thank you, guys.
I hope we meet again. I hope you work for Movito again. And one of the key things was like you picked up really fast. I remember you we gave you a task about the Maxwell controller, and you were able to finish it in a couple of weeks. When people take a lot of time just to understand the controller first. Right, so that was one of the interesting things. That's when I took notice that this guy is, we can give him more complicated tasks. But man, you did great job. I love it.
Thank you, Guru.
And good luck for your future.
Okay, hope to work with you again.
How to work with me again?
Hope to work with you again.
Okay.
Hope we work again.
I hope that too, man. I will stop recording now.